Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful as we come into your house that we can encounter your presence and experience what it is that you have for each and every one of us. Lord, today we acknowledge that it's not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. But today we've come to hear from you. Be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives. Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, as we open your word, we pray that you open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear. Open our hearts to have good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. Also, Lord God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. We would also ask it for our brothers and sisters. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we would ask that you bless all the churches that are out there preaching the gospel, lifting up the name of Jesus. Bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, for Harvest, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, for the Way, God, all the great churches that are out there, too many to name by name, God. Bless the Foursquare denominations and Assemblies of God. Bless Crossroads, God, and Lord, our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, if they're lifting up your name, preaching your truth, God, we bless them as you would bless us. Also, Lord, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the nations, Lord. We would ask that you would comfort them, protect them, encourage them, and bless them, God. May they endure to the end, to the glory of God. May you deliver them out of every trouble, every trial. And God, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. Amen. You can have a seat today. Today, as you're being seated, get your Bibles and go with me to Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, we've been in a series about the mountain of God. Today, we are finishing that and launching into something else. I just want to remind you of what Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verse number 24 says. Remember, we were talking about what we've come to. One of the things that we found out that we had come to is that we've come to the blood of Jesus. That speaks a better thing than the blood of Abel. Now, you remember Pastor Luke, last time we were together, he brought a brilliant message about this, and he said that the blood of Abel cried out for revenge, whereas the blood of Jesus cried out for redemption. And that blood of Abel, as it went into the ground, God came and he spoke to Cain. He said, do I not hear your brother's blood crying out to me? See, there was innocent blood that had been spilled. And therefore, because of that, vengeance had to be taken. There had to be some price that was paid for that. And here the blood of Jesus, the one who qualified as the Lamb of God, Jesus comes and he sheds his blood on the cross. He spills his blood on the mercy seat. And now we have come to that blood. And the Bible says that we are sprinkled in our hearts, that we are cleansed in our conscience. And now that blood of Jesus speaks better things than the blood of Abel, that it speaks redemption, that it speaks healing, that it speaks salvation. And now we have that blood of Jesus speaking in our lives. And with these thoughts in mind, I want to take a look at Hebrews 12, chapter verse number 25. Look at what Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 25 says. It says, see that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven. Now, I want you to notice something about this verse. First of all, I want you to notice that it's continuing the same thought that we talked about with the mountain of God, that there was a time when God spoke on the earth to the children of Israel and that they drew away from God, that they could not endure to hear the voice of God. So they told Moses, you hear from God and then you speak to us because we can't hear from God lest we die. But now we are under a new dispensation. We are under a new time frame. There's a new age. Jesus has gone to the cross. He shed his blood. He's gone to the Father. And now he sent his Spirit. And now he still speaks. And therefore, we do not draw away from God. And we do not go to a man to hear from God, even though you can hear from God through vessels on the earth. But now we have a direct connect. We have a direct relationship with Jesus Christ himself. And through Jesus Christ, we can come into the very presence of the Father. We can go to the throne room. We can find mercy and grace to help in a time of need. We have access to God by the blood of Jesus. And so we now no longer draw away from God, but now we can draw near. But it says, see that you do not refuse him who speaks. I want to mention to you this, is that God is a talking God, that God still speaks. Three times in this one verse, we find it saying that God is speaking. God is speaking. God is speaking. And we need not refuse him who speaks. And yet, one of the biggest struggles facing Christians today, and many of you in this church, because I've talked to you guys, I've had time to sit down, privileged time to sit down with people and hear their hearts, hear where they're at through spiritual guidance. I get the pleasure of doing that every so often when I can't. There have been times where I've talked to people at the back door as they've waited until I've greeted the thousands of people that go through my door, and then afterwards they'll wait around and they'll ask me a question, and oftentimes they're struggling with the same thing, or maybe checking the kids in. You know, my three children go to the school here, and maybe I'm picking them up after school and getting to talk to parents that have their kids in the school. And many times I find the same thread, that there's a problem that's facing Christians in churches today, is that they don't hear the voice of God. Many times people say, I don't hear it. I've never heard that audible voice. I don't know what God is speaking to me. I don't have the direction of God. I can't get a hold of the wisdom of God. I don't know what it is that God would say to me. They don't know how to hear the voice of God. Today I want to talk to you about hearing the voice of God. See, it may be a revelation to many Christians and maybe to many of you in this place today that God still speaks. Because we've been taught wrong, or maybe we've thought wrong, in that we think that God had said everything he was going to say here in the Bible, and then when he was finished with the revelation, amen, in chapter number 22, that God now got silent and that God doesn't talk anymore. And yet God is a speaking God. You'll find God is always talking. God is a talker. You know, you know what I mean when I say a talker, right? You've had people that you say, oh, watch out for that person. They're a talker, right? You see them coming and you're like, oh, shoot. Did we make eye contact? Oh, hey, yeah, no, it's cool. You don't have to come. They're coming over, right? And you just know you're going to be there for a while because they've got something to say. They're going to be talking to you. See, in the same way, many people don't realize that God has a lot to say. Now, that doesn't always mean that you'll have that hour and a half long conversation like you do with the talkers here on the earth. But God may speak something to you, and he may speak a word. He may speak several words. He may speak a sentence. He may speak a paragraph. But whatever he says, it's powerful and it's lasting, and it can have impact throughout your lifetime. One word from God you can stand on for the rest of your life. Why? Because the word of God, the Bible says, is living and active, powerful. It's sharper than any double-edged sword. God is still speaking today. And the book of Hebrews says, see that you do not refuse him who speaks from heaven. God is talking to you, and God is talking to me. God is constantly talking. In fact, when you are introduced to God right there in Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1, in the beginning, God, right, created the heavens and the earth. And what did God do? And God spoke. All throughout the Bible. First time you're introduced to God, you find God speaking, and God has not stopped speaking since. God is not silent. God is not distant. God wants to have a personal, intimate relationship with you, and God wants to speak to you about every area of your life. Can somebody in this place say amen? Amen. See, the problem is that not that God isn't speaking. The problem is that we aren't hearing. Hello. Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse number 27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. See, we've got a lot of sheep, a lot of people who call themselves Christians, and yet they're not hearing the voice of God. Either number one, you're not really a sheep. Hello. Or number two, we haven't tuned our hearts to hear from the voice of God. Jesus says it is a privilege of his sheep to hear the voice of God, that he knows us and that we follow him because we can hear his voice. And therefore, for all of us, we need to understand how it is that God speaks to us, because God wants to talk to you about your life. God wants to give you direction. God wants to give you the wisdom of God. God wants to talk to you about your parenting. God wants to talk to you about your family. God wants to talk to you about direction and vision. God wants to give you purpose and destiny. God wants to encourage you. He wants to talk to you about your business and your finances. God wants to share with you how to be a witness and how to do the mighty acts that he wants you to do here on the earth. See, God is talking, but the problem is that we're not hearing what God is saying. So we need to understand how it is that God speaks to us. There are two primary ways that God speaks to us presently today. Two primary ways. Now, God can use any number of ways. God does whatever he pleases, the Bible says. Therefore, God could use any different ways to talk to us that he would like to. You find supernatural ways God spoke to different people through an angel or through a donkey that talked to a mad prophet. God can do whatever he wants to do. But today, as believers, there are two primary ways that God speaks to us. First one is this, the word. The B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. Come on, we learned this as a child, right? God is speaking to us through his word. The Bible says in John chapter 1, verse 1, pretty much the genesis of the New Testament, we're introduced or reintroduced, I should say, to God and to Jesus. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. Jesus is that word because the word became flesh, verse number 14, and dwelt among us. See, Jesus is the living visual representation of Almighty God. Hebrews, the first chapter, God who spoke in times past to our fathers through the prophets now speaks to us through his son, Jesus Christ. Christ. Jesus is the eternal word of God. Jesus is the spoken word of God. He was the wisdom at God's side through creation that was rejoicing in his works. Jesus is the Logos. The Logos is a Greek word for the entirety of the Bible, all of the scriptures, everything you have from cover to cover, that is the Logos. That is the entirety of the word of God. That is Jesus in the flesh now is the word of God to us. So God speaks to us through his word. If you ever wanted to hear God's voice, all you got to do is open up your Bible and God will start speaking to you through his word. You never have to wonder what the will of God is for your life. In the Bible, you will find the will of God. You never have to wonder how to do life, what's pleasing to God, what's not pleasing to God. How can I be successful? How can I have a great family? How can I have a great life? How can I have a great business? It's all here in the word of God. God will speak to you through his word. It's right here in black and white, or if you have a red letter edition, in red and white. God's speaking to us through his word. Look at what Jesus says in John, the 6th chapter. Turn there with me. John chapter number 6. John chapter number 6, Jesus is speaking to his disciples, to a gathered assembly as well, to the Pharisees. And here he is, and he starts talking. He's ruffling feathers, getting people mad. And he starts to talk to them about the word. And look at what he says in John chapter 6, verse number 63. John chapter 6, verse number 63. He says, "It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life." See, sometimes people look at this as a dead, antiquated word that's no longer relevant to our lives. And yet Jesus says, "My word is spirit, and my word is life." That means it is immediately applicable to every area of our life. This is not antiquated. This has not gone out of fashion. It has not gone out of style. It is completely relevant. It is completely important. It should be given all of our attention. We should be getting into this book so this book can get into us. Why? Because his words are spirit and they are life. The word of God is living and active. The word of God is now. It is always present. It is the word of God that is given to us, and God will speak to you through his word. God wants to talk. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Many of you guys could quote this. "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work," right? But look at verse number 16. Look at what it says. "All scripture is given by inspiration of God." That word inspiration literally means God breathed. You heard about the Apostle Paul, right, breathing out threats against the church. "I'm going to kill you," right? "I'm going to get you. I'm going to drag you out of your home and lock you up." What is he doing? He's talking. So in the same way, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. All scripture is God-breathed. That means when you read the scriptures, when you read in your Bible that God loves you, when you read in your Bible that God will fill you, when you read in your Bible that God has plans and a purpose for your life, that he wants to do you good, that he's got a future and a hope for you, when you read that, that is God breathing the word of God. That is God speaking the Spirit of God and the life of God into your heart and your life. God wants to speak to you. You can find in the word that God gives direction through his word. You can find that your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. You want direction? You want to know what God wants from your life? You want to know where to go and what to do? God will give it to you through his word. You need encouragement. Many times people just need to be encouraged. "I'm out there on my own. I don't got anybody to lift me up." Listen, all you got to do is get into the book. Why? Because the book will get into you and you can find discouraged people. King David, here he is. He lost everything. He sat down and had a good cry. Some of you guys know what that feels like because you just had it this morning on your way to church, right? And so here you are. But what did David do? David strengthened himself in the Lord. You can find in the Psalms people that said, "Why so downcast, oh my soul? Put your hope in God." You can find encouragement that you need from the word of God. What else can you find in the word? You can find peace. You know, we look to the world and we have trouble. But what did Jesus say? "In the world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world, and my peace I leave to you. My peace I give you, and I do not give as the world gives." In other words, he's not going to take it back. No, he's going to give you peace that's not based on circumstances. He's going to give you peace based on who he is. You can have the peace of God in the word of God. What else can you have? You can have truth. Many people are confused and don't know who to listen to, who's right, who's wrong. Well, the education system says this, and science says this, and the social system say that, and, you know, my family said this, and you know, the neighborhood that I grow up in, this is how it was, and we don't really know what truth is. We're all confused. Listen, if you want to get some clarity, all you got to do is open the Bible and start to learn this thing and start to live this thing, and you will find out the truth of God for each and every one of your lives. Two primary ways that God speaks to us. Number one is the word. Second one is this, through the Spirit. Through the Spirit. Now, the word is the easy one, right? Because you have it here physically in your hands. You can read it, and you can understand it, and you can know God is speaking to me through that. But the Spirit's the hard one. Here's why, is because we're often trying to decipher, is that God, is that me, is that the devil, who is it talking to me? You know, I've never heard the audible voice. I don't know what God is speaking to me. Maybe the pastor can tell me what God is speaking, but guess what, your pastor, me, right here, I have never heard an audible voice from God, but I know I've heard the voice of God. See, you cannot get saved unless you had been hearing the voice of God. Why? Because your spirit man was dead and God called you to life. You had to respond to the call of God. Yes, I will give my heart and life to Jesus. And you are now born again. Why? Because the Spirit brought you life through that word which was spoken. Therefore, you heard that word and it went down into your heart and it produced life in you. See, that entrance, that tugging, that longing, you didn't even know that you were hearing the voice of God and responding to Him. And yet God was speaking to you. You say, but I didn't hear an audible voice get saved. I didn't hear an audible voice that you're dead in your sins. I didn't hear any of that. No, you didn't. Physically, but spiritually you did, and it brought you life. In the same way, sometimes we're looking for these miraculous thunderings and lightning bolts. We're looking for that voice that shook the earth, right? And yet we don't realize that oftentimes in the Word of God, it says that it's a still small whisper. Where does that whisper come? Does it come to the ear? No, it comes to the heart. See, because we are three-part beings. We are body, soul, and spirit, right? And when you are born again, it's your spirit man that is made brand new. And now you are seated together with Christ in heavenly places. That means if you ever want to have a talk with Jesus, all you got to do is look over your shoulder and say, hey, Jesus. Why? Because you're right there with Him. God is not far from any one of us. And guess what? The Spirit of God has now come to live on the inside of you. Therefore, when God speaks, He's going to speak from the place where He is. He's in your heart. The heart is the seat of the soul and the spirit. And so if you're wondering, is it me? If it's coming from here, take a look inside and see if that's where God is whispering. Now, let me show you how to understand whether or not it's God, whether or not it's you, or whether it's not the devil. Okay, you're in John chapter 6. Turn with me to John chapter number 14. Okay, everybody tracking? Everybody good? Praise the Lord. John chapter 14. John chapter 15, John chapter 16, you will find the Holy Spirit's job description woven throughout these passages, okay? So if you ever want to know about the Holy Spirit, find out about this, okay? Now, the Holy Spirit is not like Star Wars, an impersonal force that connects and binds the universe together and that all of us flow as a part of. No, that is not the Holy Spirit. Remember, we are a three-part being. We understand ourselves. God is a three-part being. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right? So the Holy Spirit is God now living on the inside of us. It's the Spirit of Christ. It's the Spirit of God. He has many other names as well. We're going to read some of those, okay? The Holy Spirit is a person who will talk to you. Let's read about it. John chapter 14, verse number 26. John chapter 14, verse 26 says, but the helper, everybody say helper, the Holy Spirit. See, in case you were wondering who that was, Jesus defines, it's the Holy Spirit, guys, okay? The helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things. Now, can I ask you a question? How are you taught? Somebody spoke something to you, right? Most of the time. And they told you about something, and you listened, you heard, and you started to understand, you acquired it, and you put it in practice in your life. Or they did show and tell, right? They took you through a process of an experience and then said, see how that worked? See what you did there? See how that happened when this took place, right? There was some instruction that was given. There had to be something that was communicated. The Holy Spirit will teach you. He will communicate. The Holy Spirit will speak to your heart. He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Now, Jesus has spoken. Jesus is the Word. So if the Holy Spirit is bringing back all things that I said to you, that is the Holy Spirit bringing back to your remembrance the Bible, right? He's bringing back to your remembrance the Scriptures. Therefore, sometimes when you're seeking God and God plants a Scripture in your heart, we miss it and we think, I remembered a Scripture. No, the Holy Spirit spoke that Scripture to you at that moment. Okay? You were hearing the voice of God. You didn't even realize it. Why? Because the Holy Spirit will bring back to your remembrance all things that Jesus had spoken to you. That's why if you're perplexed, you're having a problem, and all of a sudden a Bible verse comes to your mind, that's the Holy Spirit talking to you. But it was so subtle, and it was right here that we think, oh, that was just me remembering a Scripture. No, the Holy Spirit's talking. Are we hearing what He's saying to us? Went through an experience and we came out better on the other side and we learned some things. Holy Spirit's talking to you. Holy Spirit's leading you. Holy Spirit's guiding you. He's in constant communication, and yet we don't even recognize what the Spirit is doing. Now, the question still remains, how do I know if it's me? How do I know if it's God? How do I know if it's the devil? Here's how. The Spirit cannot speak anything contrary to the Word because they are one. Okay? So, let's look at it. John chapter 16 this time. John chapter 16. Okay, a couple pages over for some of you guys. Maybe just look over on the other side of your page. John chapter 16 and verse number 13. Look at what it says. Jesus is speaking. He says, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. Notice the Holy Spirit is not going to act independently of the truth or the Word of God. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is the person of truth. Therefore, whatever the Holy Spirit speaks will be in line and in agreement with the Word of God. Okay? So if you hear something that goes against the Word of God, that is not the Holy Spirit. Okay? And look at the rest of the verse, and he will show you things to come. Now, we'll talk about this. So, okay, practically, how does this look? There's something that I want to do. And as I want to do it, I hear inside my heart, go ahead, do it. And I say, well, I'd really like to do it. But then when I look in the Word of God, I read in the Word of God that the Bible says, no, don't do it. Was that the Holy Spirit? Come on, you can talk to me today. This is an interactive sermon. You gotta play. You gotta participate. You didn't come to sit on the sidelines and spectate. Okay, church is not a spectator sport. This is a full contact. This is a sport that you're getting involved in. You are not on the sidelines. You are the players, right? What we do in here counts out there. So if you hear something that you want to do that is contrary to the Word of God, is it the Holy Spirit? No. And yet there are many. I'm gonna meddle in your business. Some of y'all, get ready. Gird thine loins, everybody. Many Christians are living their lives and they pray about it. Oh, I prayed, God, me and my significant other, that good-looking thing that you gave me, Lord, they're such a blessing from you, God. They're so good-looking. They're so wonderful. And God, you know, would it be okay if we slept together? You know, because God, I had a friend who told me, why would you buy a car without first test driving it, God? And I want to take a little test drive. I want to slam the doors and kick the tires a little bit. Uh-oh. And I feel like God told me that it was okay. And so we went ahead because God gave me permission. Oh, no, he didn't. Because the Word of God said that fornicators will not inherit the kingdom of God. Therefore, that was not the Spirit. That was your flesh and the devil getting together and having a heyday. Okay? Not a lot of amens in this place. That's all right. That's all right. I told you I'm a meddle in your business. You know, I was praying about it, and I was saying, God, this is just not right. Why should I have to pay taxes? The government is so corrupt, and they already got theirs, and now why should I have to pay my taxes? So you know what I did? I just cooked the books a little bit, and I just made things work out, and you know what? I'm going to give more money to the church. Listen, God does not want your dirty money. God does not want blood on your money. God will cast that out of the temple because that is not God's speech. Jesus said, render to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what God, you better pay your taxes, somebody. Hello. Man, I knew we should have gone to that other church down the street today, honey. You think we could slip out while he's not looking? I love you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. See, the Spirit cannot speak anything contrary to the Word because they are one. And the Spirit will not only speak the Word, but he will also show you things to come. You know, the Holy Spirit will warn you. When you get up in the morning, sometimes you have a feeling, going to be a good day. Going to be a good day. Holy Spirit's talking to you. It is going to be a good day. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Then all the proverbial stuff hits the proverbial fan, right? What was the Holy Spirit doing to you? He was stirring you up. He was getting you ready that no matter what the circumstances come, it's a good day because God's on the throne. Jesus has gotten me. I'm not going to let this ruin my day. My day is blessed of Almighty God. Sometimes you'll wake up and the Holy Spirit will show you not only good things, he'll show you some bad things too. Hey, watch out. You're going to get a phone call from your relative. You just be nice. Mm-hmm. You just be nice. What happens? Lo and behold, you get that phone call. They're ho-humming. They are so out of faith. It's just not even, pleasant. And they're wanting you to jump in their pity party. And now all of a sudden, when you don't jump in with them, they start attacking you. And what do? You want to attack right back, right? You dirty little, and you're just getting ready to let them have it. And the Holy Spirit says, I told you to be nice. And what do? I love you. We'll talk about this later. Amen. And then what do? Lord Jesus, I just give them to you because I can't do nothing with them. Right? Go get them, Holy Spirit. He'll show you things to come. See, in church, we see the agreement of the Word and the Spirit. You know that? Because this is the house of God. This is Bethel. This is the place where Jacob said, how awesome is this place? God is speaking to me. There, the ladder ascends into heaven. The angels descending upon it. God starts speaking purpose, starts speaking destiny. How awesome is this? This is the church of God. This is Bethel. This is the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. And what happens when we come to church? The man of God, the woman of God, whoever's up here, whatever vessel God chooses to use, starts speaking the word of God. And we don't preach nothing in this church but the Bible. Hello, come on, somebody. We're not preaching internet blog suggestions. We're not preaching Reader's Digest or O Magazine. We're not preaching whatever latest thing we heard on the television or on the podcast. This is coming straight from God. This is the Bible, and this is the Holy Spirit speaking to you. You ever gone to church? And after church, man, you come up to the preacher and you say, God spoke to me. And when you said this, it just went right into my heart. And the preacher looked at you with confusion and said, I never said that. See, the Holy Spirit was talking to you here in church. Ephesians chapter number 1, verse number 23 in the Message paraphrase, the church is Christ's body in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence. See, Jesus is speaking in his church. Because Jesus is the senior pastor. Jesus is the over shepherd. I am not the senior pastor of the church. Jesus is the senior pastor of this church. I'm just an under shepherd, just a servant who's declaring to you the word of the Lord today. From the Bible and through the power of the Holy Spirit, God is speaking to each and every one of you right now in this place. Now, with these simple and abundant ways of hearing God's voice, why do we still have such a hard time hearing from God? Because some of you guys came to this place and you started hearing about this subject. You said, praise God. I've been thinking about this. I've been hoping that God would speak to me. And now here he is. And I give you the two primary ways that God speaks. He speaks through his word. He speaks through his spirit. And you go, that's wonderful. But there's no new revelation. I already know that. So then why am I still not hearing the voice of God? Glad you asked the question. First reason is this, is that we can listen to something, but not hear. Any parents in this place want to stand up and testify about how their children can listen but not hear? Anybody know what I'm talking about in this place? Any parents can say, oh, yeah, I know, and maybe you want to slap someone on the way down. No, I'm just, don't slap them, all right? They're okay. You're in church. It's a safe place, all right? I was sitting at the table the other day. I was checking my emails on my phone. TV was on behind me. Kids came in screaming, yelling, running around. I'm just tuning everything out. And my wife, Jessica, she starts talking, right? She's over here and she's talking to me. She's saying something. I'm and still checking the emails and And then all of a sudden, she starts laughing at me. And I looked up finally and I said, why are you laughing? She goes, did you hear what I just said? And I said, yeah. And I repeated everything back to her, but I was like, I don't get it. Why are you laughing? And she says, honey, you're not hearing me. And so I set down the emails, turned the phone off, pushed it to the side, tuned the kids out, tuned the TV out, and I looked directly at my wife, and she repeated everything back, and this time we started laughing together. Why? Because I heard her. I wasn't just listening. I was finally hearing. You know, God can be speaking to you. You can come to church each and every week. You can get into the Word every day. You can be praying every day. And you can be listening but not hearing. Amen. Heard a story of Franklin Roosevelt. You remember Franklin Roosevelt, our president here in the United States? He was getting tired of all the meetings, getting tired of all the galas and the balls and the dinners and all that kind of stuff. And he just was kind of bored with it all. Getting frustrated. It's the same old, bunch of people blowing smoke, you know, and all that kind of stuff, putting on a mask and think that you're wonderful when really they don't even like you and all that kind of stuff. And so here he is, and he's got this reception line. He's greeting people as they're coming in for a dinner, and he decides he's going to have a little fun. And so as he's greeting people, hello, hi, how are you? Then he started mumbling to people as they came in. I murdered my grandmother this morning. I murdered my grandmother this morning. And as the people came in, he would say, I murdered my grandmother this morning. Their response would be, wonderful. I murdered my grandmother this morning. You're great. I murdered my grandmother this morning. Thank you. I murdered my grandmother this morning. Oh, that's awesome. Until finally, the ambassador from Bolivia came walking in and he shook his hand. He said, I murdered my grandmother this morning. Very perplexed, but still keeping it cool, the ambassador to Bolivia leaned in and he said, sir, I'm sure she had it coming. See, we can be listening and yet not hearing. We can tell God, God, you're wonderful. God, you're great. God, you're awesome. And yet when God speaks to us, we can just give him whatever pat answer we had and play church and play Christian and wonder why we're not getting the answers we need. And yet in Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse number 1, it says, walk prudently when you go to the house of God. In other words, know what you're doing when you go. When you go to God, whether you're coming to church, whether you're approaching the Bible, the Word of God, whether you're approaching the Spirit in prayer, whether you're approaching life and you're listening, look at what it says, and draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they do evil. Listen, guys, in prayer, it's more important that you hear the voice of God than that God hears your voice. Now, that doesn't mean that God shouldn't hear your voice, okay? Know what I'm saying here. You need to pray. You need to make your voice heard before Almighty God. But when you're praying, don't let it be a monologue. It needs to be a dialogue. You need to pray, and then you need to quiet your soul, and you need to listen so that you can hear the voice of God. Otherwise, you're going to miss what the Spirit is speaking. Draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools. This is not just babbling some scripted prayer. This is not about just reading the Word and that's all it is. No, this is about us coming together and saying, God, your servant is listening. Will you speak? See, there are many people who listen but don't hear. They're full of the Scripture, full of preaching. You know, in our society these days, we've got everything available to us. There has never been a time in history when there has been as much Word available to Christians as it is right now. See, because it used to be, in the Old Testament times, you had to go to the prophet. That's all you had. Or you had to go to synagogue once a week, and you got to hear them read from the Word of God. Then later on, as it came down, then you had to go to the priest eventually. And then you had the apostolic thing that happened after Jesus sent the Spirit to the church. Now Jesus gives the Word of God to everybody, right? And so it increased on the earth. And then you get the Gutenberg press. Everybody starts to get a Bible, right? And now it's not only the family Bible. Now everybody's got a Bible. And now we don't just have one Bible. We've got many translations of the Bible. In fact, we've got all these translations. I've got translations that I will never touch, never read, because I don't speak those languages. But they are on my cell phone right now. And I can pull them up at any time in any place that I want to, because it is accessible to each and every one of us. We have more Word available to us than anyone has ever had in the history of the world. And we can listen to all kinds of preachings. You know, it used to be people just go to one church, just listen to one stream of thinking from one pastor. Now they're listening to podcasts. They're listening to preaching. You could buy the series. You could buy the CDs. You could read the books. You've got everything available to you. And there's lots of people that are full of Scripture, that are full of the Word, that are full of preaching and teaching, but they're full of hot air because they haven't heard a thing from the voice of God. They're letting other people tell them all about their Christianity when they're not getting it direct from heaven. And they're not having that deep personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They're letting everybody else say everything about them. I meet people all the time. Oh, so-and-so said this, and so-and-so said that, and you shouldn't be teaching this, pastor, because I heard somebody over here on the other side of the world. I don't care what they say. God told me in his Word to preach that and teach that. That's what we're going to teach in this church. We can listen to something but still not hear. But why do we still have such a hard time? Second reason is this, is because hearing the voice of God is our choice. We can choose whether we hear the voice of God or we can choose whether we turn our ears away from hearing God. That's why the scripture in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25 says, see that you do not refuse him. See, it's a choice whether or not we hear from God. It's a choice what we do with what God has spoken to us. 2 Timothy chapter 4, turn there with me. 2 Timothy chapter number 4. Towards the back of your Bible, you'll find 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter number 4. Verse number 3 and verse number 4, take a look at what it says. Apostle Paul's writing to his protege Timothy. Starts talking about what's going to happen. And he says in chapter number 4, verse number 3 of 2 Timothy, he says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Doctrine is systems of teaching, plain and simple. So he says, the time will come when they will not endure sound teaching or sound doctrine. Can I tell you guys something? That time is now. There are destructive doctrines of demons that have been introduced into the church that people are accepting hook, line, and sinker. People are saying, oh, it's okay, you know, society's gone this way, and so we're going to start going that way in the church. And why does the church have to be so antiquated? Why do you guys have to be haters? Why do you guys have to keep people out of the church? And listen, we're not keeping anybody out of the church. Everybody can come to the church, but when you come to the church, this is the standard. This is the rule. This is the line, and we do not bend this to our will. We bend our will to this. I don't care what society does. I don't care how many people are screaming about it. Listen, I'm going to hook, line, and sinker to what God has to say. I'm going to stick with what God says. I'm going to line up with God's word and with God's spirit, and therefore, I'm not going to endure the unsound doctrine. Get that out of this church. Cast it out. I'm not doing that. Why? Because a little leaven leavens the whole lump. It will weave its way all in through the church if we allow it. If we allow it. The time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires. Because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. Verse 4, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables, fairy tales, children's stories. Did you know there are more people today that are buying into zombies, vampires, Frankensteins, all sorts of things that they're believing in those things and trying to become those things because they have turned aside the fables. They are allowing themselves to go after every lust of the flesh and to do things that are not fitting for the body. And yet, this has crept its way into the church because people will not endure sound doctrine. Listen, if you're going to hear the voice of God and be in rebellion, you will not hear the voice of God. As long as you're disobedient to God, you're not going to hear God's voice. That's a word for somebody in this place. You need to repent and turn, and God will open up the windows and pour out his word on you. You will hear his voice once again when you start walking in obedience. But it's time to repent. It's time to turn from those things, those evil things. Time to turn away from your own desires. Turn to God's desires. See, these people are drowning in life. And Jesus is on the boat. And Jesus sends out a line to them. He sends out a rope. And he says, grab a hold of the rope. And what do they want to do? They're drowning. And Jesus says, grab hold of the rope. And what do they want to do? They want to talk about the rope. You know, I don't think that the rope is ever found in Scripture. I've seen other boats down the shore, and they didn't send a rope out. They sent little boats. And I think that's really how it should be done. You know, if this was God, he should be more nice. He should be nice about it. There should be a personal touch. It shouldn't be so impersonal. You know, the rope method, I think, is something that you will never see in the Scriptures. And you know, people think that it's just, you know, the way that it should be. But that's a little impersonal, isn't it? That's a little rude for them to send out a rope. I think they should send out little boats, you know, because it shouldn't be so big. It should be the little things, you know. And it should be personal. It should adapt to me, and they should come and carry me up on the boat, and they should put a towel around me. And Jesus says, you're drowning. Grab the stinking rope. Found a verse in Ecclesiastes chapter number 9 that just rocked me. It stuck with me ever since I read it. And I think it's appropriate for what we're talking about today. Ecclesiastes chapter number 9, verse number 17. Look at what it says. Words of the wise spoken quietly should be heard rather than the shout of a ruler of fools. Do you know, the Bible says that there are many voices in this world, none without significance. Many things being said. You cannot go anywhere without having yourself just an immense amount of things coming at you. There's constantly things shouting us. There's the media, there's the politics, there's the education system, there's community, there's society, there's world events, there's the news. There's all sorts of stuff that's shouting at us. You cannot go to the grocery store without having a barrage of advertisements coming at you. You can't drive on the freeway without billboards constantly telling you what to do. And now billboards aren't just one message. There's several messages because they're digital billboards. You get on your phone, you get on the different social media, all that kind of stuff, and there's advertisements mixed in with everything telling you how you should be, what you should do, how you should look, how you should think. It's constantly coming at us every day. The devil's shouting in your ear. You got the flesh shouting at you. And then God is whispering. And the Bible says that words of the wise, who alone is wise? Who alone has the words of truth? Who alone has direction for your life? See, are you going to listen to the devil? Are you going to listen to the flesh? Are you going to listen to the world's systems? Or are you going to tune in to the Spirit of God, which is speaking to you today? Because God's whispers should be heard greater than the shouts of fools. There's so much foolishness out there in the world, and we're buying into it because they're loud. But we're letting 2% of the population govern for us what we should be doing. No, let's let God Almighty define for us what life should be like and listen to His whispers greater than the shouts of the fools. God is speaking to each and every one of us. How does He do it? Two primary ways. Number one, through His Word. Number two, through His Spirit. So if we have these things available to us in abundance, why do we still have such a hard time? Number one is because we can listen to something but not hear. And number two, because hearing is our choice. It's a choice that we have to make each and every day. God, I'm going to choose to listen to Your Spirit. God, I'm going to choose to instantly obey the voice of Your Spirit. God, I'm going to line up with Your Word. Why? Because I heard Your voice and I'm following You. I am Your sheep. You are my shepherd. Let's pray together. Father, we come to You in the name of Jesus. Lord, today we draw near to hear, not to give the sacrifice of fools. Help us, Lord, to follow You. Help us to hear You greater. Help us to tune our hearts in and not just listen, but to hear. And God, may we turn our ears to You, not turn away from You. And Lord, we love You and we give You praise in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody in agreement said, amen. Did anybody hear the voice of God today? Come on. Come on. Let's give God a great big praise. Because for each and every one of us in this place, the Bible speaks to us. And just as we heard from the book of Hebrews, there's a scripture that says, today, if you will hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as is in the rebellion. Because if they didn't live who refused Him here on the earth, what greater punishment do you think those who hear His voice today and yet refuse Him? We need to be careful. We need to watch our lives. And today, God is speaking to your heart and your life. I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to answer the question in your heart. No, the answer, but You and God. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Just answer that question in your heart. You don't have to answer it out loud. Sometimes people think they're going to go to heaven because they say all roads lead to heaven. You know that nowhere in the Bible does it say all roads lead to heaven. It's like me saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it. In the same way, what makes us think that just because Jesus went to the cross and that because God loves us, that now ollie oxen free, everybody's going to make it without having to do anything? No, God tells us exactly how to get to heaven here in His Word. And in fact, the Bible says the way is narrow and there are few who find it, but the way to destruction is wide. And there are many who will go on to destruction. Today, I want to shine some light on the path for you. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people think they're going to heaven because they were raised in church. Parents told them they were Christians growing up. Born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. You wear a cross or St. Christopher on your neck. Had you baptized a Christian? Took your religious classes like Sunday school, Sabbath school, catechism class? But you know that nowhere in the Bible say you'd be raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian growing up, because you're born in America, that you get to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. Nowhere in the Bible say just be raised in church, you get to go to heaven. And you know, sometimes people are so foolish, they think, well, we're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu. We're Christians, right? Wrong. Nowhere in the Bible say that there's a default category because you're not something else, you become a Christian. Sometimes people think, well, you know what, I'm going to go to heaven because I'm in church right now. I mean, it wasn't just a childish thing for me. This is it right now. I'm an adult, and I call myself a Christian, I'm in church. But you know that nowhere in the Bible says you can sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. It's like me saying, you know what, I really want to be a fish. So I go down to the Pacific Ocean, sit in the water, blow bubbles, call myself a fish, and think that's going to make me a fish. Nope, just some crazy dude sitting in the water. Eventually be slimy and pruny, but never a fish. Same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Sometimes people think if I can just do enough in church, volunteer enough, serve enough, if I can teach enough, maybe if I can, get a membership card, that'll make me approved of God. But, you know, God's not looking for your volunteer hours sheet before you can enter the gates of heaven. He's not looking for membership cards before you can enter the gates of heaven. It's not about how much you've done in church, because that's back to good works. And did you know that the Bible says no man will be justified before Him with good works? Because the standard is perfection to get into heaven based on our good works. And the only one who is perfect, His name is Jesus. Can't be good enough to get into heaven. In the same way, you can't be bad enough to keep you out. Can't clean up your act and say, you know what, I've been so bad, God's not going to let me in. I need to go clean up my act first. No, you need to let God come into your heart and clean up your act. You got the process backwards. Sometimes people think, well, I'm going to go to heaven because I know God. I know who Jesus is. Celebrate Christmas and Easter every year in my life. Sing the songs. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, no. Because if that was the case and you'd read your Bible, you would know that demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and they shudder. See, they know their end. They know they're headed for hell. They know there's fiery indignation waiting for them. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures. You'll find that in your Bible. The devil quoting scriptures. Wow. And yet he's not a Christian headed for heaven. No, he's being reserved in chains for eternal blackness and darkness and fire and fervent heat. And if you don't want to share in the devil's fate, then you need to listen up right now. Because some of you guys, if you were to die today, you wouldn't make it to heaven, but you would end up in hell. And I want to talk to you about your life and make sure you, before you leave this place, that you're right with God, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell, because God doesn't want you to go to hell. Even more so than you or I don't want you to go to hell. Listen, I love you enough to tell you the truth today, not patty cake, not play games, we're not sugarcoating it. Not here to be liked by you, I love you. And therefore, I'm going to tell you the truth. There's only one way you're going to get to heaven. Jesus outlines it here in his word. In John, the third chapter, he's speaking to a religious leader of his day. We would have thought this guy was good with God. He was going to heaven. He knew scriptures. He did a lot of good deeds. He was in his church. And yet Jesus doesn't pat him on the back and say, you're doing great. Just keep doing what you're doing. No, he says, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. It's just that simple. You must be born again. Now, I know. Our society's been screaming about being born again. They've made it out to be some weirdo, goofy thing that no one wants to have any part of. But listen, should we listen to the shouts of fools or to the wisdom of God? What is being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and all of your life. You've surrendered it to him. That moment when God comes into your heart and your life, you're born again. He makes you brand new on the inside out, cleans up your act from the inside out, little by little. It's a process in life. But it starts when you surrender everything to him. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. He says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Pretty gross, pretty graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, wouldn't you think? But what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? What's the little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again? An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. Because what did he say? He said, if you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today is your day of salvation. I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to simply raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, well, wait a second. Hold on, because I might be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be, but get over it. You say, you're so insensitive. No, I'm not. What does the Bible say? Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see your hand go up. He says, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. You can either get right with God, simply raising your hand, acknowledging your need for Jesus, then we're going to pray together. Simple prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. Or you can sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right. And you made your choice. Your call today. Who should raise your hand in a moment? You've been running from God instead of to God. I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand? If you're not sure about your salvation, today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand? If you've never done this before, come on. Let's go all out for God today, giving him all of your heart and all of your life. Or finally, who should raise your hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. Come on, stop messing with God. Let's go all out for Jesus today. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down. Time to get your hand up. If you're online, wherever you're at, watching across the nation and around the world, hey, you can raise your hand and then we'll pray that prayer with you as well. If you want to be included in that prayer, this is your time, this is your moment. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one. God bless you. Who else today? Who else? There's two. There's three. There's four. Got you. God bless you. There's four. There's five and six over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Six. Up on top. There's seven. Got you over there. Thank you. Eight right here. I got you, my man. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? There's eight. There's nine up there. Thank you. There's 10 over here. Got you. There's 11. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? 11 wise people already. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? If that's you, just raise it up high. If I don't see you, give me a little wave. Okay, sometimes that little movement. Thank you. Got you. God bless you. Thank you. Thanks for the wave. I appreciate you guys up there. God bless you. Who else today? About 12 or 13. There's 14. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? 14. Yes, I got you right here. Thank you. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? If I saw you, you're good. If I haven't seen you though, come on, just lift it up high for me. Thank you right there. Got you. Number 15. God bless you. Who else today? Anybody else real quick? About 15 wise people. Thank you, number 16. Thank you, number 17 and 18. Now listen, is that your choice or are they lifting your hand? You got to lift your hand on your own, okay? Thank you, 16 and 17. They're doing it on their own. They just like each other, so they were holding hands. Praise God. Anybody else real quick? That's okay. That's okay, but it's your choice. Got to do it on your own. You know, a woman nudges her husband and says, you don't do this. You better be sleeping on the couch tonight. Listen, he's not going to get saved. He's, yeah, I want to sleep in bed tonight, so not going to get saved. It's got to be your choice, your call. Anybody else? Real quick, about 16 or 17. Where are you at, number 18? Thank you, number 18. Where are you at, number 19? Come on, let's go for God today. Let's go for God today. Number 19, come on. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yes, yes, you should. Thank you, number 19. Come on, don't you just feel number 20. Number 20, you just know. You've been waiting, and God has been speaking to your heart, and you've been resisting Him. It's time to let go. Time to let God. Come on, this is your day of salvation, number 20. Where are you at? If that's you, God speak. Thank you, number 20. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hallelujah. Here's what we're going to do. We want to pray with you, okay? Can I take a couple minutes and pray with these guys? Will you guys allow me? We got a couple minutes over. I want to respect your time, but will you allow me to pray with them today? All right, if you raised your hand, or there's five more of you, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Why don't you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Why don't you get in the aisle and meet me up front. Okay, let's let them come forward, so don't leave during this time. Let's let them come forward. Let's all stand and welcome them. You raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. You come right now. Come on down to the front. Come on down to the front right now. Get your stuff, get a friend, get in the aisle, meet me up front. Come on. If you raise your hand, you should raise your hand. You come right now. Come on down. Come on down. They're coming. You can come too. From the foyer, you can come in. Come on. From the family rooms, if your children raise their hand, you can bring them. They'll remember this. Come on down. And restore. Come on, let's give them a hand. They're still coming. You can come too.
Dull voice of God speak to you.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's keep it going for them. They're still coming. They're still coming.
Speak your words of life to heal the wounded and broken heart.
You know, it's a shame. There are people who raised their hand, but they still didn't come. Listen, you don't get saved by raising your hand. You got to give God all of your heart. You got to give God all of your life. Don't resist the Holy Spirit. If God spoke to you today, come on. Come on. God loves you so much. He's holding up this whole church service just for you. Will you come? Come on. Come on. Will you come? Let's give him a hand one more time. Will you come? Will you come? Will you come? All right, well, for those of you that didn't come, but you can hear my voice, I know you can, because if you walked out in the foyer, or if you're in the bathroom, or if you're down there on the breeze, I got speakers all the way out there. And I love you. God loves you. And I pray that God keeps you, and you can come back to that place of salvation. Hey, you guys up front, put a smile on your face. This is the best decision of your entire life, right here, right now. All right? I want to lead you in that prayer. Okay, everybody is excited for you guys. This is a new family right here. Everybody's excited for you guys. You're going to become a part of the family of God. You're going to be born again into a new family. That old man, that old screw up, that old rebel, that old rascal, gone. Okay, you got a brand new start with a brand new heart today. I don't know how God does that. You're going to wake up tomorrow, look the same, smell the same, okay? But you're going to be brand new on the inside, okay? So this happens when you pray. Prayer is simply talking to God, like we said, okay? And right now, you're going to give God all your heart, you're going to give God all your life. I'm going to lead you in a short, simple prayer. Easy phrases, want you to repeat them out loud if you have the ability, okay? Everybody else is going to join in with us just to encourage you. This is not about your words, so if you mess up on a couple words, don't worry about it. This is about your heart right now. So let's bow our heads, let's close our eyes, and put your hearts on the Lord and say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all my heart and all my life. Come into my heart, be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me my sin, wash me with your blood, cleanse me of my past, and fill me with your Holy Spirit. And let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm a child of God. I hear his voice, and I follow him for the rest of my days. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give God a great big praise. Woo! Yes! Hallelujah! All right, everybody up front. Want to get some free information in your hands. Want to follow up with you guys. Don't want to just leave you here like, what do I do now that I'm a Christian? Okay, we want to encourage you. Right over here is my friend, Pastor Joel, waving at you. Good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? You already got past this dude, okay? That's about as weird as you're going to get today. He's cool. He's going to give you some free information, talk to you about a program we have here, some friends in church that'll encourage you, get you strong in the ways of the Lord, okay? And then they'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. Make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel for just a couple minutes. Let's give him a hand as they go. Come on, hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today.